the seventh day. Thank you for bringing us to the last Sabbath of 2014. As we gear up to going to 2015, my prayer is that your church will become vastly more concerned about the condition and state of their lives so that they can be ready to meet you when you choose to burst the clouds and come back. We are intensely looking forward to that day. Thank you for the moment to hear from you now. We give you our full attention. We know that what you have to say now is important for our living and for our existence. So may every ear be tuned to the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is our prayer in his precious name. Amen. I really felt like just saying the benediction so we can go home. Gallery. Elder McLeod preached my sermon for me. Might as well just go home. No such luck. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Beginning at verse 23. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning at verse 23. I'm going to read 23 to 25. And then we're going to skip on down to verse 35 to 37. Hebrews chapter 10, 23 to 25, and then 35 to 37. Hear the word of the Lord. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. If you're reading the King James Version, it says, let us stir up one another, or let us provoke one another to love and good works. Then verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Verse 35. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. I'm going to read verse 25 again. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. A good reason why you should go to church in 2015. The monotony of coming to church is real. We saunter into the building every seventh day of the week. And maybe there are some in here who go in every first day of the week. But for this congregation, every seventh day of the week, we come through the doors. We are greeted at the doors by the same faces. We shake hands. We smile, if we can muster it. We greet one another as we're taking off our coats and our hats if it's wintertime. If it's summertime, we parade in front of each other like peacocks in our summer gear. We greet each other, and there's some people, truth be told, that you greet more warmly than others, because there are some people that you fancy more than others. Most of you will walk to Sister Olivia, and you will embrace her, and the love you pour on her will be genuine, because Sister Olivia will never harm a fly, and she's probably one of the nicest people in this congregation. Let the church say,
amen.
Yeah. Then you walk over, and you see Sheldon Griffiths. Oh, Lord Almighty, you begin to crawl. And in your mind, you begin to say to yourself, Lord, help me to greet Brother Sheldon. I need your strength and power right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. You walk up to Sheldon, and you open your arm, but it's tight. It ain't like loose like how you were with Sister Olivia. It's tight. Just open your arm and Sheldon. Come through the doors, you get inside church, and you go through the monotony of service after service after service. And you sit there, and some days are good, and some days are not so good, and some days are exciting, and some days are boring, and sometimes the pastor is good, and sometimes the pastor ain't good. Sometimes your favorite pastor is preaching, and sometimes the one you have to pray just as hard for stands up to speak. Sometimes you wish he would just get up and say the benediction and go home. Sometimes you come into church, it's the last Sabbath of the year, you just wanted to hurry up and sit down, because if we could just get home, we'll be all right. But Elder McLeod alluded to something when he was standing here, and it is so true. We have been lulled into the monotony of church attendance. We are not taking the opportunity to relish it as much as we can, because we have forgotten that soon a day will come when you won't be able to meet like this. This is normal. I can walk into church however I feel, whenever I feel, in whatever attitude I feel like, because it's just a church. And time is ticking. See, we take it for granted because we don't have an urgency in our souls about the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, pardon me for being a Seventh-day Adventist preacher today, but one of my jobs is to talk about the second coming of Jesus Christ and to impress on you the importance of the reality that it will be sooner than you think. I'm not meeting anybody today. I'm just trying to tell you that it's going to happen. See, Peter already wrote down that there are in our midst, and he wrote this back for his day, but it's even truer for this day, that there are scoffers amongst us who sit down in church right beside you and who are church members just like you, but they've been in this thing so long that they're sitting there and they're saying to themselves, we've been talking about the second coming for a long time. We ain't seen nothing yet. I'm reminded that one of the greatest tricks the devil ever played on the world is to make the world believe that you have all the time in the world. Jesus, in Matthew 24, said something about his time. He said, when you see wars and rumors of wars, when you see earthquakes in diverse places, when you see calamities and pestilence, when you see diseases cropping up that you never knew would have existed ever in your life, when you see tornadoes happening in places where tornadoes never happened before, when you see earthquakes shaking ground where there is no fault line, when you see hurricanes and typhoons wiping out entire nations, when you see the sea swell so high that it covers up vast portions of nations, when you see calamities befalling you on every hand, on your right and on your left, he says, look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. He also said, as much as the lightning strikes from the east to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. It will be that fast, it will be unpredictable, but the verse I love is when he says, no man knows the day nor the hour. So the one thing that I do know is that Jesus is coming again. That he will burst the clouds. And I don't know about you, but I can't wait for the day when Jesus comes again. You can stay down here if you want to. But I don't want to pay taxes anymore. I don't want to pay a mortgage anymore. I don't even want to have to dry clean anymore. I don't want to have to buy a brand new car today just so 7 years later it gets old and out of date. I don't even want a cell phone. I don't want a tablet. I don't want a computer. Just give me Jesus. All the live long day, 24/7, 365. As a matter of fact, I don't even want to have a calendar. I don't want to have hours and seconds and minutes in a day. I just need to have Jesus, because the Bible says that every day will be like a Sabbath. You can sit there cool, calm, and collected all you want to, but I'm ready to go home with him. I don't know about you. So the writer of Hebrews says, go to church. Listen to what he said. Go to church. Not as the custom of some is. Because there are enough people today who don't go to church or who periodically attend church. Now let me define going to church. It causes us to say that going to church does not mean church attendance. Let me clarify this. Because there are a lot of people who enter church but who don't go to church. I wish I had a church today. Listen to what I'm saying. A lot of people who enter church, but not a lot of people who go to church. We have boiled church down to be a place you go to be entertained. We don't enter church already with the mentality to worship. We enter church expecting that we will be hyped into worship. I know I'm preaching today because y'all are quiet. We enter church not to worship, but to be hyped into worship. And if the church is not up to our standard of worship, then we will find somewhere else to go. Because what we do in this generation is we church hop all over the place. Can I talk about it for a second? We love to find, oh, is it good over here today? Okay, it's good. Okay, then we'll go over here today. And if it's not good, well, we'll go on the other one today. And because you have so many churches within a vicinity of each other, you just church hop from one place to the other until you find the right spot where you can get yourself aroused into worship, because you have not entered the church with an attitude of worship, because you're really not a worshiper. And why do you have that attitude? Because during the week, it ain't about Jesus. It's about you. And about what you want. And about what you want to do. And about compromising your faith. And about doing all the things that you think necessary for your enjoyment. But you don't think about God until Sabbath. And even now, as I'm preaching now, there's somebody in this room who can't wait for tonight. Because tonight is more important than the present. Tonight, the one that will whisper in your ear, the sweet nothings, is more important than the still small voice of God whispering in your ear right now. Because we have made other people more important than God. And so God's word and the echoing of it and the bellowing of it in the last days that remind you to stay faithful to his cause so that you can be saved is no longer important. And you tune out when you should be tuning in, and you tune in what you should be tuning out. And the author of Hebrews says, don't forsake assembling yourselves together, as the custom of some is. But I love what he says. He says, you ought to come to church. Listen to the reason, because here's the good reason. You ought to come to church so that you can provoke one another to good works and to godly living. You ever gone to church and there's somebody at church that you can't stand? Some of y'all sitting in the pew looking at me going, I'm looking at him right now. But you ever gone to church and you're sitting in church with somebody you just can't stand? And one of your prayers is, Lord, help them to find somewhere else to go. And what you don't know is that they're sitting on the other side going, Lord, help them to find somewhere else to go. You ever thought to yourself, why did God put us in the same church if we can't stand one another? And then there's that person that you love to call the holier-than-thou self-righteous person. Because every time they see you, they come to you and says, have you kept on keeping on? Did you stray this week, Brother Joseph? Did you stay away from the Christmas cake that Sister Joseph soaked this week, Brother Joseph? Remember, Jesus doesn't like that, Brother Joseph. You ever met that person? Always in your face. And the funny thing is, they annoy your soul. Because you just want to be left alone. I just want to be able to come to church however I feel, however I want. Let me tell you the big problem I have with some of us today when it comes to church. We enter church looking any way we feel like looking. Because we've reached a day and an age where church, you get angry at a church for instilling a dress code, but you're not angry when the club instills a dress code. You look up the club's name, you see that there's a dress code, you go to Forever 21, Sean. Because yesterday was Boxing Day, right? You were on your feet all day selling stuff to somebody who was buying the dress code to go to the club.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
And so you will put on what the club tells you to show up in. But when you come to church to meet the Savior of the universe and to meet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, you walk in the building feeling any way you feel because Jesus said, come as I am. And if nobody can tell me. And my favorite phrase, don't judge me.
Yes.
You don't know me.
Yes.
I don't need to know you to know you. Because you have shown me who you are. And Maya Angelou said, when somebody shows you who they are, believe them. When you get inside this building, remember who you're coming in here for. When you step through these doors, remember who's already here. And so none of us leave here with false theology. He was outside with you before you came in. He's not all of a sudden finding out about who you are once you step through the door. He was with you on Tuesday morning. And on Thursday night, God was with you. And the writer in Hebrews says, forsake not yet some of yourself together. Here's the good reason why you ought to come to church. He said, because the closer we draw to the coming of the Lord is the more you ought to be in church.
Yeah.
And not only this, being in church in the original language here does not just mean church attendance, it means church participation.
Yeah.
Because what a lot of us are doing is we're not participating anymore in church. God has put you in this building because there are people in here that will provoke you to good works. Oh, shoot. There are people in this building that will provoke you to good works because the tendency of us is to be lazy. Listen to your preacher today. All of us are working hard so that we can live easier lives. And we forget that slothfulness is a sin. Y'all are killing yourselves at both ends of the candle, burning the wick at both ends to make more money, to live easier lives. Because you just want to do nothing. Not that you want to have enough money so that somebody else can do for you what you should be doing for yourself. You're a good cook, but you're trying to make enough money so you can have your own personal chef. You have a decent house. It's more decent than the wooden zip shack that you came out of. But you're trying to make more money so that you can live in the up parts of Toronto and hobnob with the wealthy and the rich and the famous. Mm-hmm. You're driving a car that God has kept going. Masking tape around some of the pipes in the car, trying to keep all the fluids in. Hello? Yeah, duct tape, you got all that duct tape right around them pipes, trying to keep all that fluid in. Your muffler should have fell off a long time ago, but you took a coat hanger and you round it up in a certain way to hang it up underneath the car. Am I the only one? Should have changed your tires a long time ago, but you're just praying that it doesn't tread off. You're thanking Jesus for the mild winter we've had so far because you know you can't afford snow tires, so you're just praying one day at a time, dear Lord, one day at a time. Walk into your cupboard or your kitchen kitchen, you open your cupboard, and you look inside your cupboard, and you see beans again. Canned. And you're hoping and praying, Lord, let me make enough one day so that steak can be my regular diet. Yeah, if you're holier, Swiss steak can be my regular diet. You're praying because you want the better life, and what you're forgetting is that the better life is not on this earth. The better life is when you get up there. The Bible says, store not your treasures down here, but store your treasures up there. And sometimes we forget that, Sister Griffiths, and so sometimes we need to be in church. And the Bible says, come more often as you see the day approaching, because there's someone in here who will encourage you not to forget what it is that you've been keeping the faith for all this time. Because we'll forget. So you got people that will provoke you. Pastors that will provoke you. Elders that will provoke you. Deacons that will provoke you. Sabbath school superintendents that will provoke you. It's a strong word, but it's a good word. Larry, I'm glad you're in church today. Here's why I'm glad you're in church today. Because this week, where I was putting this sermon together, is a story I'm going to tell right now that you're in. I didn't know you were coming to church today. We didn't talk about it. You didn't tell me. Milton didn't tell me. That's Milton's brother, by the way. Big Larry. Who's younger Larry with little Milton.